only 13% of organizations have a mature FinOps program, according to the FinOps Foundation. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. I'm joined by Yasmin from StormForge, recently acquired by CloudBolt. Welcome to the audience, and welcome to the show. How are you doing? How's your new role going? What's new?
Hey, Paul. Thanks for having me. It's week two, and honestly, it feels like we've been working together forever. Could be because we had a partnership that started about a little over a year ago, but it's been great. It's a really good fit for us, both culturally and just product-wise. So it's been really exciting in the new role.
Yeah, that's awesome. I mean, you and I have been working together for many years now, right? And so I'm really excited for you. I'm really excited about the role. I'm excited for StormForge. It's really, really powerful that the CloudBolt opportunity and action come together. Because, you know, I was just at KubeCon. I was at Google Cloud Next this last couple of weeks. Lots of things happening, you know, and I keep asking, getting the question when I think about modernization and topics around this, is why is FinOps important, right? Well, when we look at this, right, we see that, you know, according to the state of the FinOps survey, right, which is the various maturity levels of FinOps really is an impact to a lot of organizations, right? Only 7.5% of cloud FinOps practitioners were in the what they call a pre-crawl level. And 37.1% said that they're still trying to figure out FinOps in the crawl stage. So we're really just trying to understand how this works. But when we looked at this, like, we also find that almost 43% of practitioners were in the walk stage. So there's very different levels of maturity when it comes to FinOps and when it comes to, you know, Kubernetes, when it comes to modernization, when it comes to bringing it all together. I think a lot of organizations are trying to just deliver against their modernization practices using the tech stack that they have, trying to use Kubernetes in it. But then they realize either after the fact, or they really should realize before the fact, why FinOps is important. So Yasmin, when we look at, you know, bringing FinOps and Kubernetes together, why is that important?
I mean, it's important because you can't have siloed organizations that are kind of, you have the FinOps people looking at reports and they get one line item that's Kubernetes, it's a black box. What did they do with this? Why does this line item keep increasing? And then you have the folks on the platform team that are kind of in the trenches doing the day to day. And someone maybe knocks on their metaphorical door and says, hey, like, costs are going up, your cloud bill is increasing. You're not going to get anywhere if it's kind of that throwing it over the wall type approach. We saw this with DevOps. We saw this with DevSecOps. And now it's FinOps, where those teams have to be brought together to be able to get anywhere productive.
Yeah, but with only 12%, almost 13% of respondents stating that they're in the run stage where cloud FinOps is really part of their daily operation and culture, is it too soon to kind of bring these things together? Or is it, I mean, I get it from our conversations, like, it makes a lot of sense because you don't want to over-provision. Although a lot of times the teams that are doing the deployments are the ones that just, they don't look at the budget. They just over-provision and put what they need in place. But is it too soon?
I don't think it's too soon, because I think the reason why only so few people are in the run stage is because they don't have the tools to get them there. They need help going from crawl, walk, run. And honestly, this is where I believe that software is the best solution to bring those teams together and help them get to that run stage where it's not like three steps from now. It's no, I can actually start there because I have the tools that empower me to do so.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I agree with you. I'm hoping the organizations that are watching this also agree, because, I mean, a lot of what I hear is, after these modernization practice or deployments and instantiations kind of go to market, they realize that it's not sustainable because they haven't rationalized the cost that they put into place. So they have to go back and revisit what that means, which is interesting, because when I looked at the CloudBolt acquisition of StormForge, the insights that, you know, to the actions that kind of bring it together, I thought there was a lot of synergies, real great synergies between the two. Why don't you touch a little bit about that? Because I think that the audience would care about this.
Yeah, honestly, that's what I love about the CloudBolt platform and kind of makes this the best fit. So for us, StormForge, we do automated right sizing. And so that means you're doing your optimization automatically, and the byproduct of setting these things correctly and reducing the over-provision workloads is you save resources, you save money. And where CloudBolt kind of takes a point of view on this very strongly, is you can't just have FinOps reporting tools that tell you what you should do, give you all these insights. Okay, now go find a way to figure it out with the team. The actions are upfront. The optimization is what sets the platform apart. And they even track in the product of the time it takes for you to get an insight that, hey, you should go do something, and for you to actually take that action. And it's not just about tracking that, but giving you the tools to take those actions. So you pull up the UI and you have, okay, here are all my optimization actions I can go do right now to get my cost bill down, my cloud cost down. And that's where StormForge is a great fit, because we do that naturally as the tool is an automated optimization tool. So I really like that piece from CloudBolt.
So I have a question for you, because, you know, we have FinOps X coming up. It's a, you know, obviously a big event that's focused around this as well. There's a lot of companies there, right? There, you know, 88, I think, was the last running number that I saw, but a lot of FinOps companies. What is a differentiator that ties it together? I know that the acquisition makes it a stronger differentiator, but what, maybe you could tell the audience what that differentiation means, because I think, again, when you're looking at that infancy of like understanding versus the maturity of actually doing, there's kind of a number of areas where your differentiation stands out. And I think the audience can really appreciate that.
Yeah. So to be honest, this FinOpsX will be my first one that I'll be able to attend. So I'm excited about that and to just talk to the users there. But in kind of the FinOps market, there's some tools that I won't name, but they've been around forever and they're owned by the giants. And there's kind of a status quo when it comes to cloud cost reporting of, hey, we're going to tell you your cost is through AWS, GCP, Azure. We'll trend it for you. We'll give it to you in a dashboard. But that's kind of the majority of the value there, is just telling you information. And where CloudBolt's been setting themselves apart from a tooling standpoint is, one, we can move fast. We're small. We're, you know, not tiny, but like we are still at the point where we can move fast and deliver features quickly. And the focus on how do we give you the fastest optimizations that you can just go act on right the day that you install the software. And that really is what differentiates the CloudBolt platform. And then under the hood, just having a really intelligent like re-rating engine for things like bill ops, having a very powerful database of all the different types of insights that we can then use machine learning and AI to take that a step further and say, like, here are the anomalies in your environment. And by the way, we've already acted on it for you. You didn't have to wait, see something, and then go do something about it. It's all of that is automatically happening. So what I like about what sets CloudBolt apart is part of what's in StormForge's DNA. So it's a nice fit, and I'm excited to see people's reaction at FinOpsX of taking that approach into the Kubernetes world.
Yeah, I can't wait to see you there. I mean, I agree with you. I think it's going to be absolutely exciting times to see this. You know, one of the things I found, Yasmin, in my research is 75% of respondents indicated that they're using 6 to 15 different tools to gather information about everything across the CI/CD pipeline, across the SDLC, and across their operations in general. And 54% of organizations are looking to consolidate that down to a single view and like have less tools. One of the things that I found very interesting is the fact that a lot of these FinOps practices or tools that are in place are really just reported. There's no real actionable insights. So can you touch on that a little bit? Because I think that's a big part as well.
Yeah. I mean, I think the challenge of not having any of those actions in there is, what are you going to do with an insight? You then need to go meet with a team. You might need to go meet with a few people, right, in different orgs. Say, from a Kubernetes standpoint, if you want to, you know, you have over provisioning across a handful of namespaces. If you want to go do something about that, you have to go get the developers involved. You have to go get the platform engineers involved. You have to make sure that you have buy-in. And then also, where do you fit on their prioritization stack? Is this the most important thing to them? Probably not. Not saying cost isn't important, but to the people that are trying to keep the systems up and going and develop new features, new functionality, and move the business forward, cost sometimes takes a backseat, which is really hard for the FinOps folks that are really trying to push the envelope on, hey, let's go cut costs and become more efficient. Having the actions in there to say, hey, I don't need to just be reported on this and then go try and chase people down to do something about it. I just turn the feature on and all of a sudden I'm starting to do optimization automatically, and I have all of the progress reports in the UI to see how that's impacting. I can then turn it around and instead of asking them to go do something, tell them what has been done and the impacts of that.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. So, you know, the thing that also kind of came to mind when you were talking was the fact that, you know, well, maybe I'll ask you the question. I was thinking the fact that, like, you know, that the persona that you talk to is no, it's not the procurement, right? It's not just about looking at the numbers going, oh, here's all the numbers and here's how it works. Although that's a part of it. I think that a major part is actually the practitioners that are doing the deployment. Would you agree?
Exactly, exactly. You need their buy-in. Otherwise, you know, it's wasted effort.
Yeah. And so taking those actionable insights, the buy-in is one thing, but then like taking those actionable insights and showing that it's usable for them to deploy. You know, you made a point of saying, you know, that sometimes the money doesn't matter, but I think the money does matter once you start actually doing this, these efforts, these modernization efforts, then you start seeing that bill creep up, right? And you also can identify real quickly how much is over-provisioned, so you don't need to use that much. So you can kind of give back to the organization and they can actually increase the amount of efforts that they're doing rather than kind of putting it out there. So it's a win across the board in my mind.
Exactly. And once you start getting those wins, then you go back to those teams and you're like, hey, we did this together. Here's the impact. Here's why it was a success. Now let's go tackle maybe some of the harder applications, maybe some production workloads that people were hesitant to kind of right size. Using those wins early on helps kind of empower the teams going forward.
So let me ask you this then. Why can't organizations just, you know, execute changes and assume they're going to save money? Like, what? Why do they need to have tools? And how do the silos between the groups really, you know, impact this? And what do you need for software? Because there's a whole slew of things you can do. And I bet a lot of the audience has gone, well, I can do this myself. I don't need any tools to do this. But that is, I think the devils are in the details. What do you think?
It is. And it's a challenge at scale too, because say you were going to go right size a single workload. Great. You can look at a chart and then maybe you can come up with what the right requests and limits should be. But that's what they should be at that point. So on a Monday, is that the same as what you need on a Saturday? How do you kind of account for that variability? And then that's for a single workload. You probably have thousands and thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of workloads. So and an individual human can do that across a handful, but they can't do that at that level of scale. And then once you actually want to deploy those, you have a centralized like platform engineering team. They have to work with the developers to make sure, are they confident in deploying those recommendations? Are they okay taking the suggestions? And they'll always want to kind of put in their own input as well to say like, well, my application's a little different. You know, everyone thinks their application's different. How do you take into account this or that? That problem just starts to multiply and exponentially gets worse at scale. So you need software that can actually codify those inputs from the developers and then the automation that makes it repeatable so that you can go give this to someone and say, hey, it's just going to run. You don't have to handle it yourself.
Yeah, I think a lot of people believe that their environment is bespoke and unique to them. And you know, that's okay. And a lot of them are, but I mean, they don't realize that there's a commonality between a lot of these problems that needs to be solved. Hey, so Yasmin, I want to ask you a question. I mean, you know, now that the, you know, the acquisition's announced and it's kind of all the buzz is out there, what, you know, like when we look at the trends, we look at what's happening with FinOpsX coming up, what are the big things that you're going to work on together with CloudBolt? Because I think that's going to really impact some of the trends that we're seeing in the market.
Yeah. So one of the big ones that I'm a little biased, obviously, for the excitement is the StormForge platform has always given you kind of estimates into your resources saved and how much that's going to cost you. But now with CloudBolt, we have access to billing data, to the CUR. We can really overlay at a very granular level your Kubernetes costs on top of the product. So like personally, very excited about that. But on the flip side, I think from a like market standpoint, what is a super exciting thing that we're working on is how we take our machine learning and automation approach to Kubernetes workloads and apply it to the rest of cloud infrastructure. So think traditional VMs, think storage, networking. How do you take that kind of look at the trends in the data, come up with the right insights, and then also automatically take action across the rest of the cloud infrastructure? So that's probably the most exciting part.
Yeah, I think that's going to be great. You know, I definitely think it impacts what I'm seeing in our research. You know, there's a lot here for people to think about, especially when we look at those numbers about maturity. Where would you advise the audience to go to like learn more, right? Because this is just kind of like, you know, some folks, this is just really new and they're just trying to figure it out. Other folks get it. So like, but you know, where would you advise people to go?
So if you want to learn more about StormForge or get started, honestly, we have a free trial that anyone can install it on their own infrastructure and get started there. We also have a sandbox where people can just poke around and see what the product looks like, see what it does without installing anything. And those links can be provided after, but it's app.stormforge.io/sandbox or app.stormforge.io/signup if you want to actually install it on your own. And if you go to the CloudBolt website, we've kind of taken over about the announcement at just cloudbolt.io/stormforge. We have kind of a lot more information there. Why did we do this acquisition? How did the two products come together? And what's the value for the end user?
Yasmin, I want to thank you for being my guest today on the show. And a big thanks to the audience for tuning in. You know, we really do appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. It's really a powerful place for us to kind of get out the trends and message. That wraps up this episode. And we'll be back next Wednesday for another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talents shaping the application development world. Whether you're deploying to the edge, building AI, modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social. And if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach out to me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building. Thank you.